Hello everyone, I am Dr. Manika Gupta. I am an assistant professor at Department of Geology, University of Delhi. Today I will be taking this module discussion on classification accuracy assessment and errors. By the end of this module discussion, you would be able to understand why do we need to assess the accuracy of the classified images, how can we perform the accuracy assessment, and what are the various methods through which we can quantitatively assess whether the image has been accurately classified or there are some misclassified pixels. This is an important part of an image classification when we classify the image through digital processing. So, as you know, in the previous module we discussed about classification techniques, the hard classification techniques like supervised classification and unsupervised classification. We also informed you that both these techniques, once we have classified an image, it is important that we calculate the accuracy of the classified images. Why do we need an accuracy assessment? We need an accuracy assessment because once we classify an image, we need to be sure that whether the pixel we have classified into a particular class actually belongs to that class or not. Now, what do I mean by actually being present? Now, suppose you have an image and you want to classify it into a water body. The classification automatically classifies it as water. But if you go for the ground truth at a regional place, maybe the GPS location doesn't show it as a clear water. It might be turbid water or it might be a waterlogged area. So this implies what we actually classified as water might have been a waterlogged area. So this amounts to misclassification of the pixel. Now why is this occurring? Because the reflectance is being captured for water. It doesn't justify or differentiate between being a water body or a waterlogged area. So, we need an accuracy assessment to understand that the water area is different from the waterlogged area and we need to reclassify those pixels. So, before we reclassify, we always assure ourselves that we need to have an accuracy assessment. So, basically, what is an accuracy assessment? It's an agreement between the classified image and the reference data. The reference data is the one which we assume to be a standard data, or we assume that it represents a reality. Now, what could be treated as a reference data? The GPS points where we locate, or the GPS points, the aerial photographs, or even some of the satellite data which have a very fine resolution. So, suppose you classify an image using a Landsat data, so it has a coarser resolution of 30 meters. It can be have a reference data from suppose a data which has a 1 meter resolution or even finer resolution, maybe through your aerial photographs. So that is how you do an accuracy assessment. Now, in accuracy assessment, also there can be errors. So now we need to understand before we make the accuracy assessment, the data which we collect as the reference data has to be also correctly or accurately identified. What do I mean by that? I mean, like if you have a classified image for December and you collect the reference data in April, there would be a difference in the data collection and your accuracy assessment would be low. Why I am saying the accuracy assessment would be low? For example, in December there was a wheat plot. But in April or May, the wheat is already harvested and it's no more a wheat plot. It might be a fallow land, which might not be available to use even for the next season. So, if you measure the accuracy of this classified image of December based on the reference data of April, you would get a less accurate assessment. So, you need to understand that even the accuracy assessment has to be clearly defined, and you need to note what was the timing of the reference data collection, and you have to have the satellite data also for the same time period. Secondly, how can an error occur? An error can occur if you have a minimum number of sample points which do not represent the whole region. What do I mean by that? I mean, suppose in a classified image you have 5 classes on which you classified this image. But in actuality, when you go for the reference data collection, you missed out one of the classes. So when you do an accuracy assessment, you will not know whether the fifth class which you have identified or classified is actually present in the field site or not. This would result in actually very low accuracy for the fifth class, even though an overall accuracy might be high. So you need to know the region where you have to have the assessment that whether the data has been properly collected or not. Now, how do you know whether the collection or how many observational points you need from one of the sites? It's usually considered that you should have a minimum of 50 observations for a particular land cover site. And how can you determine how, or actually if you have a bigger region and you have a lot of sources or resources, you can have even more points. Now, what is the equation we can use to calculate how many number of samples we need? Is a very basic equation, which is N is equal to Z into PQ upon E square. So this is the number of samples you need. This is your 2 into standard deviation of the number of samples we need. This is what is the expected accuracy. Suppose you will never get an 100% accuracy. So what is the accuracy you aim for? It's an experimental thing, so never 100%. How much do you expect? Maybe 85 to 95. So you can choose one number between these two, and Q is 1 minus P, and E square is your allowable error. So that if your percentage here was 85%, your allowable error is your 15%. So this is the error you are actually allowing in your accuracy assessment. So in this way, you can calculate an average number of samples you would require for estimating or doing an accuracy assessment. However, if this number is very large and you do not have the resources for that, then you can minimize or optimize the number of samples required in each of the classes. Now, the second option is, when I say you can optimize it, you need to now design a field sampling type. What is a field sampling type? How do we design it? There are various methods to do that. One is your simple random method. What do I mean by simple random method? Suppose you have one geographical area here, and these lines represent different classes. So in this image, you have four classes. If I say we have a simple random classification or simple random point locations, what do we mean random? Random implies we have the sample locations at any of the places. So what is the limitation of this method? Suppose we had a fifth class here. So if we have a fifth class here, we might miss this location totally, and we may not have any sample in this area. So we might employ another methods for this calculation. There could be, like, again, if I draw this same diagram here and I have these same classes, I could employ stratified random. Stratified random implies that we have the samplings in every of the classes, but in every classes it is random. So at least we would have two or three points here, two, three points here, and maybe 2 points, 3 points here, and one. So it is a bit better than your random classification, because here you are classifying the image with points being in every of the land use land cover class. Other than this, you can have other approaches also. So a third sampling design could be systematic. Now, what do I imply by systematic? Systematic implies we divide the area into a grid, and then we calculate the or collect the points one from each of these grids. So when we are collecting the data at each of these points, this is known as systemic or regular grids. Instead of doing a regular grid, we could also have non-systemic. What do we imply by non-systemic? So the land use is similar here, but this was the grid we made here. In non-systemic, this is, suppose, our, again, the land use classes, which was there. So we would have one at least in each of these grid, but random again. But again, this is in the grid. So this is different from this classification for the sampling. What is the fifth? The fifth is the cluster. In your cluster analysis, again, this is your sample. These are your land use, land cover classes. And what do? We assign one point, suppose here, and we make a cluster around this for sampling. And we collect the points on these instead of this point. So this considers a mean vector for that point, and we collect the data around that point. So similar here. Now in this, why is this different from these two? In here, we are focusing on collection of data in each category. But here, this cluster can occur in another class also. So the cluster might not be present in one of the single classes. So that is the difference between them. Now, which sampling method you have to use, it depends how much data you can collect, what are your resources, and which method would be better for you. Once you have collected these data, you can utilize it for accuracy assessment. Now, once we have considered the reference data, we can accurately make the assessment using two methods or comparison using two methods. That could be either non-site specific or site specific. Now, what do I mean by both of these? It means that if you have a geographical area here and you have these various classes, now if I want to have a non-site specific accuracy assessment, it considers this whole area and then accurately measures or does the accuracy assessment of it. However, if we are doing a site specific, it implies even in this same area, we have these classes here, but as you know, it's a raster data, so you would have these pixel locations. So this is how your data would be represented. In site specific, we would have the calculation at or the accuracy assessment at every one of these pixels. So here we had it based on area, so it was non-site specific. Here it's based on the cell value or the grid value. So this is a site specific accuracy assessment. Usually we carry out this kind of assessment if we have a lot of data with us, and this is carried out if we actually do not have much of the data. So we will be concentrating on this for our further studies. So what would be the first accuracy assessment? Anybody would imagine it to be the overall accuracy. Now what do I mean by overall accuracy? Overall accuracy is how many pixels in each of the classes were correctly classified based on your reference data. So it kind of gives you a data where you know, okay, you classified accurately this much of data and this much of was misclassified. However, it doesn't tell you what? It doesn't tell you which class was misclassified or either all of the classes were misclassified. So it's a very summarized value. It's also a quantitative thing, but alone overall accuracy is not sufficient for the assessment of your classified image. So as an example, how do you do this? Suppose for that you need to create an error matrix or a confusion matrix, commonly known as or other thing as contingency table. What do you do in that? Suppose this is your, you create an Excel sheet. Suppose you have two classes in your data. One is urban and one is vegetation. So on the row side, it's your true data or the reference data. And on this side, you have a classified data. So here also you have urban and vegetation. This is your classified data. This is your classified data here. Okay, so in this we realize, suppose this is your urban and this is your vegetation suppose. So how many are urban pixels, how many are vegetation pixels we get for both the true condition and the classified condition. So suppose the true condition urban is 10 and vegetation true condition is 10. However, when the classified image urban or this vegetation here is 5 and here we may have 15. Now you can write the column total and the row total. So row total is here 20 25, in total this is 40, and here you have 15 and 25. So this forms your error matrix. How can this error matrix be used? Now this error matrix can be used to calculate overall accuracy. How do we do that? Overall accuracy implies we take the diagonal pixels, which is this one. So 10 pixels from the true are correctly identified in urban, and 15 pixels are correctly identified in vegetation class. So your overall accuracy of this image is 25 upon 40. 40 is your total number of pixels in this class. So this is equivalent to 62%. So the overall accuracy of this image is only 62%. So, but this doesn't tell us whether urban had misclassification or the vegetation had misclassification. Now, how do we do that? We have two types of classification errors there, which we can calculate. One is your omission error and the other is your commission error. Omission error, as the word tells you, it implies how many pixels were not correctly identified. So in omission error, we would have, suppose here, if you look at this 5 pixels, these 5 pixels in true data were actually urban. You can see here, this is your true data and here we have 5. But in classified data, these 5 come under vegetation. So these pixels are actually misclassified here. How do we do that now? So the true pixels in urban were 15 and 5 were misclassified. So your omission error is 5 upon 15. So this 5 upon 15 is your omission error. It can also give you a producer accuracy, which is 1 minus 5 upon 15. This is one of the errors. The second error is your commission error. What do we in commission error? In commission error, we identify the pixels, these. What are these now? These have been classified as urban, but these are supposed to be vegetation. So what is your commission error? Your commission error is actually this 10 upon 20. So this is equal to approximately 50%. So this is 50% and it is your commission error. Your commission error gives you an user accuracy also, which is again 1 minus commission error, which again is equal to 50%. So these are the three things which you classify or assess. So one gave you an overall accuracy, which was a summarized quantitative value. Omission error and the commission error here gave you the classification errors for each of the classes. And these also come under the heads of user accuracy and producer accuracy. Finally, we come to Kappa coefficient, which is another matrix that is used in accuracy assessment. Now, why do we need this matrix or statistical assessment? We need this statistical assessment because the overall accuracy or the classification errors or the accuracies due to these errors could still give us a false hope that the classification was accurate. Why is that? Because it's a digital automated process, and digital automated process, you can still get some good pixels classified as the actual data which we want. So in that case, we would still get a good accuracy, but we won't know whether it is a chance agreement or it's an actual agreement. So that is the reason coefficient or the Kappa coefficient comes into picture. Now, what is a Kappa coefficient? Kappa coefficient is a ratio between a chance agreement, ratio of a difference between chance agreement and the reference data, and chance agreement and your random classifier. What do I imply by random classifier? Random classifier is for the same image for which you have done either a supervised classification or an unsupervised classification, on that same image, you perform another classifications, maybe different unsupervised classification technique or maybe different supervised classification method. So that would amount to a random classification. So if you have these two or three classifications and then you measure it with your accuracy or the kappa coefficient, you will realize that you get certain coefficient which varies between 0 to 1. So if this kappa coefficient value is 0, it implies that there's any accuracy which we are getting is a chance agreement and the image is not being correctly classified. And as we move from 0 to 1, it would imply 1 is a very good image classification and the image you classified is very accurate and represents our truth condition or the reference condition which we are following. So in all, if you want to classify, once you have classified the image, your assessment requires you to have your overall accuracy, your omission error, your commission error, and the kappa coefficient. These are the four metrics which we need before we can say the classified image is accurate. What is the limitations of these accuracy assessment now? As I have already suggested that the sampling design is important when you are doing an accuracy assessment. Second is the timing, which also I suggested in the beginning of the module. The timing of the reference data collection, the accuracy assessment is based on. Then the photo registration. What do I mean by photo registration? When you have a satellite image or an aerial photograph which is being utilized as a reference data, you need to geometrically correct it and orthorectify it so that it can be superimposed upon your classified image. If there is a problem in the spatial locations, you might still get an error even though your classified image would be correct. So you need to be careful with the registration of these images. Secondly, the GPS locations are supposed to be accurate. If they are not accurate, again you can misclassify or misrepresent the actual classification data. Another error could be due to if the suppose your source data is at a high coarser resolution or the reference data is a coarser resolution and your satellite data is at a finer resolution. So there can be mixed pixels for your observed data and an image actually you might not have that mixed pixels. So you need to realize what is the dominant class there and you need to classify it according to the dominant class. Other limitation of the accuracy assessment could be due to the boundary edges. Now what do I imply by boundary edges? Boundary edges are, suppose you have a pixel and it is representing water body, but in natural condition a water body may extend to the second pixel half, only half of the second pixel. That implies we could have a misclassification of if our GPS location was at the second pixel, but it was not a dominant class, and thus the image did not classify it as water, but maybe as a floodplain region. So this could result in your misclassification. Thus, this shows that once you have classified an image, you have done an accuracy assessment, you might still need to improve your classified image based on your accuracy results. How do we do that? So we have post-classification processing. Herein the expertise of the analyst comes into picture because he need to realize that what is the picture actually representing so that he can improve upon the accuracy of the classified image. So before he again improves upon, there are few methods or few processing tools he can employ there. What are those processing tools? First is your majority filter. Now what do I mean by majority filter? Suppose this is your raster data here and these are your pixels. These are your pixels and this has been classified suppose as 1, 1, 1, 1 and these are your maybe this has been classified 3 and again this may be 3 or something else, whatever be these. Now you would imagine if 4 surrounding pixels are 1 classified, then it's a rare thing to for the second this pixel to be in the 3 class. That would mean that we need to reclassify this pixel and it should belong to 1. Now if you do apply a mean filter would be we average these values. So 1 plus 3, an average of this would be 2. But in categorical data, this doesn't mean anything. This would mean there's a different class. So we don't want that. So that is why we employ here majority filter. Now what is majority filter? Majority filter is this pixel is being majority pixels surrounding it has a value of 1. So if the majority pixels have a value of 1, this pixel is recoded to 1. So it's no more as classified as 3 now, it is classified as 1. So this is one of the filters you can easily apply for the misclassified pixels. The other is, there are three more approaches to do this. Another is clumping and sieving. So clumping and sieving is similar to this. The majority filter was one of the methods. Another is your clumping and sieving. In clumping and sieving also, you sieve, like it's a kind of salt and pepper issue. If you have a large area, then you would find that a lot of pixels would be misclassified and your image would have an impression of salt and pepper, that some pixels are being misclassified there. So these pixels would be same, but this would be different. Again, here would be all same, but this would be different. So in sieving, we let out these and make it to be the upper one or the lower class. So that is your sieving. Similar is your clumping, where also you clump the majority class, and that is the class you provide to it. Now, last but not the least of the these editing tools include a manual editing tool. What is a manual editing tool? Manual editing is basically the analyst need to look at the pixel, the reference data, and reclassify it to the class he suppose it belongs to. Reclassifies the image he thinks the pixel belongs to. That's your manual editing. For this manual editing, visual interpretation again comes into picture. So you would realize that digital image classification is not complete without your visual interpretation also. So even though a system gives you an automated digital image, classified image, you still need your visual interpretation techniques to see whether it has been clearly classified or accurately classified or not. Thus, in today's times in remote sensing, usually the approach is not considered to be fully automated, but it's considered to be semi-automated. So this is the main thing about this module, where we learned about the accuracy assessment. In the end, to summarize, I would just say that you will realize that accuracy assessment is important for the classified images. Secondly, accuracy assessment is highly dependent on the reference data you have collected, the timing of the reference data, the sampling of the reference data, and even the presentation or the representation on the site where the data has been collected. Other than that, you can also realize that not only overall accuracy is important, you need to also provide the commission errors and the omission errors to suggest whether the image you have classified is accurate or not. So this gives you a quantitative assessment of the classified image. So if you provide someone with a classified image and it doesn't have an accuracy assessment, there are too many question marks on the classified image. So to give the reliability to your data, you need to have this accuracy assessment. Lastly, Kappa coefficient is also required. So not one data matrix can be used here. The statistical things should include all the four matrix for your accuracy assessment. In the end, I would also suggest that there are a lot of reading available on the through the books which have been supplied or referenced in the e-text. I'm sure if you will look at those books, you can easily have the data and understand what actually is accuracy assessment. And thank you.